Let's begin with 2 Timothy 2:15, a verse you know quite well. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a workman who does not need to be ashamed. Pause right there. Are you in a development in your Bible study where you can come before God and not be ashamed? I'm not saying you don't have more to learn, but for the experience, for the time you have professed Christianity, you can stand before God comfortable. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God. A workman need not be ashamed. Accurately, I almost used the New King James rightly, accurately handling the word of truth. This is one of our fundamental things. You know, what does it mean to be a Christian? It means we follow the word. We study the word. That's what it's all about, is that book, chapter, and verse foundation. And the challenge we face is ignoring the distraction, because there aren't but about a bazillion distractions out there that says, look, this is more fun, this is more exciting, this is more entertaining than doing Bible study. And you know what it is? Bible study's tough. I don't know who said it, but he said 2% of people think, 3% of people think they think, and 95% would rather die than think. Let that soak in a second. That's why people don't know the book. That's why we play the clergy game. Oh, he's the preacher. He's supposed to know the book. No, I'm supposed to know the book. You're right. And I'm supposed to be able to teach you the book. And you do the learning part of the book so that you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's Matthew 6:33. So you love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your being. Matthew 22:37. And you learn to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Romans 12:2. This is the core. This is the fundamental. This is one of the most essential things of Christianity. And if we don't get on board with this, well, you're just at the mercy of whatever winds tend to blow. So we get back to the book. We let the Bible be its own dictionary. That's, I think, a wonderful idea, which is so easy to do in like 99.9% of the usages. And we avoid the temptation to Americanize the Bible, or I'd like to say Arcanize the Bible, you know, because every culture, you know, if you were in New York, you'd want to look at the Bible like you were a New Yorker. And if you were out in California, you'd want to look at it like a person from California. Here in Arkansas, we've got our own particular ways. They're all good. But no, that's not what we do. The Bible was the Bible long before there was an Arkansas. Long before there was a Southern culture and all that good fried food, there was a Bible. And there were Christians doing what Christians were supposed to do before anybody ever thought of Arkansas. So what you want to do is you want to conform to the Bible message. That's what we do, because it is the word of Christ. That's John 12:48, where he says, the words that I spoke will judge you in the last day. Now, that ought to be kind of comforting in a way. He didn't say the words Clarence spoke will judge you in the last day. So the words Christ spoke. And those words got here 2,000 years before me. The only person you have to line up with is Jesus, as revealed in the scripture. In John 8:31-32, he says, if you abide in my word, and I think that's key, that's verse 31, if you abide in my word, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. He didn't say if you dabble in the word, you've got to abide in it. So the question is, how bad do you really want it? How bad do you want to get in there and get the word? Do you want it bad enough to put Facebook aside? Do you want it bad enough to turn TV off for a while? Do you want it bad enough to schedule a time daily to sit down and really learn what God wants of you? Now, if you want it that bad, you're going to make progress. But if you keep trying to squeeze it into your spare time, well, I think you're going to be in trouble. So one of the things we do is we use Bible examples, because Bible examples are just a wonderful resource. They're so good. And what stories do for us is they're easy to remember. You know, the parables of Christ, you know, you may not understand everything he meant to teach in them, but you go, oh yeah, I remember that. I remember that one too. Oh, I remember. And the Old Testament stories, you remember those, because there's something about stories that just stick in our head. Now, we can do abstract things, and you go, I don't know, I got that. And that's okay, too. Abstract is difficult to understand. Stories are rather beneficial. So Paul, he's using Old Testament stories frequently. You really need to go back to 1 Corinthians 10:1 to get this full context. We won't do that right now. But as he concludes his little section to the Corinthians, he said, these things happen to them as example, and were written for our instruction, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed that he does not fall. And what Paul did here in this text, if memory serves me right, he used seven Old Testament examples telling the Corinthians, and I'll just put it in a simple paraphrase, y'all need to get your act together. Seven Old Testament examples doing just exactly that. Romans 15:4. He said, whatever was written in earlier times was written for, get this part, this is important, our instruction, so that through the perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. That's what that was written for. That Old Testament, it's there for us. One more time, 1 Corinthians 10:6. Now these things happen as examples, and that's what we're going to talk about, examples for us so that we would not crave things, evil things, as they also crave evil things. So we go back to the Old Testament. We go back there again and again, and people are getting kind of puzzled about that sometimes. They go, well, I thought y'all were the New Testament church. I didn't think y'all used the Old Testament. And they just told me unwittingly that they don't know the New Testament, because I just gave you three passages where the New Testament told us to use the Old Testament. So if somebody says, I didn't think we used the Old Testament because we're the New Testament church, well, guess what you just told me? You don't know the New Testament. You're not even living by your own standard, because the New Testament, as we're going to use one more verse in a minute, says, use the Old Testament. It was written for us. These examples are for us. I think that's kind of neat. But we're not under the Levitical law. But we can still learn so, so much from the Old Testament. Now, I want to do just a really brief, just one slide, about why we're not under the Levitical law, but the Old Testament is still awesome. And then we'll keep this part short. We've done whole lessons on this, but this will be sufficient for the moment. In Hebrews 7:12, said, for when the priesthood is changed, the necessity there takes place, a change of law also. And they're talking about Christ being the new priest. He is the new head priest, and he is of the tribe of Judah. Under the Levitical law, you had to be of the Levitical tribe. You had to be a Levite to be a priest. But Jesus is our high priest, but he's from the tribe of Judah. So obviously the law has changed. Simple enough, not real complex logic there. I like this verse even better, but folks kind of go, for it is attested of him, that is Christ, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. And now people get all weirded out about what's Melchizedek. Don't worry about that right now. The point we want right now, is Christ of the Levitical order or is he of the order of Melchizedek? What did we just read? You are a priest forever according to the order of who? Melchizedek. Our priest, our high priest, our priesthood is not the priesthood of the Levitical priesthood. We're not even under that priesthood. We're under the high priest who is forever according to the order of Melchizedek. We are a system that follows the order of Melchizedek. That's right. That's what Scripture says. Word for word, I don't even need to interpret that. And so we can go back to the Old Testament. Amen. Now we can learn a lot of stuff. But we're not Levitical priest. We're not under that order. Now let me do one other real quick little analogy, and I think this will help. How many times have you heard the falling of America, which we are in a fall. If we don't get our act together, we're going to live to see it totally implode. How many of you heard the falling of America compared to the fall of Rome? And how many of you heard people say, we need to go back to history because people who don't know history are doomed to repeat it? You've heard that one, hadn't you? And so you go back and look what Rome did wrong and straighten up our act so we won't go down the same path they went down. And so we go back and we look at the history of Rome and the fall of Rome and the focus on the flesh and all the immorality that was eating up Rome and their focus and their obsession with entertainment and recreation. And we learn a lot. But we don't have to be under Roman rule in order to learn those lessons, do we? We can learn the lesson of history without being under the laws that governed Rome 2,000 years ago. We can learn a ton of stuff from the Old Testament, like Paul told us to do, without being subject to the Levitical law. You don't have to be under the law to learn things from it. And I wish somebody go back and study some history and get somebody back on track as far as our general society goes. So we're going to be learning from history. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture, underline that all in your mind if it's not already underlined, all scripture is inspired by God, profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. I do have one little side point. Notice he didn't say all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for recreation, entertaining, and making you just have the happiest time you ever had when we get together and have a woo-hoo good time. He said it is profitable for teaching. Not a problem with that being a little dry sometimes. Reproof, correction, and training in righteousness. You know what I like to say? It's all training anyway. So this is what we get. All scripture, we go back, we look at it, and we learn these things from it. And I think really America would be crazy wise to go back and learn some things from history also. I don't know why we, you know, I do know. So here's what happens. We're smarter. Rome got caught up in recreation, entertainment, but we're smarter than Rome. Rome got caught up in immorality and homosexuality and all kinds of really, really ugly things. But we can do the same thing we did. We can sow the same seed they sowed, but we're going to get a different crop. We can sow hatred and immorality and the flesh, but we're going to grow a godlier nation. And all of you who grew up in the 60s and the 50s and the 40s and before know that is one big, bold lie. And people are lining up at the fountain to still drink it. It's just crazy. I don't know. So we have all these Bible examples, and they're a wonderful resource. I want to hit some abuses really quick. There are those who make the mistake of saying, well, if I don't have a specific example in the Bible, then it's got to be wrong because I didn't read in the Bible a specific example of where they did this or that. I have talked with brethren who told me it was wrong to do tracts and have a tract rack in a four-year because they never read about a tract rack in the New Testament. And they're correct. You never read about a tract rack in the New Testament. We've had brethren who go, well, you can't use the radio, the newspaper, the media, the internet. Just pick your media because I never read about Paul talking on the radio. Did you? I'm like, no, I never read about Paul preaching on the radio, that kind of thing. Do you know that chalkboards have been opposed? Now, this is going back a little ways, but I have a friend whose dad preached, and this friend is my age, and his dad had the audacity to use a chalkboard. And people were indignant that he would use a chalkboard because there's no example in the Bible of anybody ever using a chalkboard. And he stooped down and wrote on the ground and said, I think Christ used the biggest chalkboard ever. That's a little humor there. Marker boards. You remember when white marker boards came out and you get to use all the colors? And there were people going, I don't know about that. Chalkboard's okay. Bed sheet. I've seen that one time. Bed sheet. They flipped the bed sheet over and have the next point on the bed. Literally, a bed sheet that they wrote on. When they came out with overhead projectors and now we have PowerPoint. Paul never used PowerPoint. Y'all can't do that. And there are actually people who say, you can't have a church building. You know, there is no example, and this is true, there is no example in the Bible of a congregation owning their own building. That's true. So every church that owns a church building is going to burn in hell forever. Here, they're inconsistent. You know, there is no example of a song leader in the New Testament. Sorry, Jeff. Dave, y'all are out of job. I'm really not sure how we're going to sing, but there's no example of one of you guys. I guess we'll just sit around and at some point or another, we'll just all start randomly singing. Do you know there is no example of a songbook in the New Testament? There really isn't. And you know there is a very, very small sliver, in the dark corners of the Restoration Movement, that says you can't use a songbook. You can only sing the Psalms because there's no example of a modern written song in the Bible. And I'm like, well, you know, these are abuses. says, look, authority is not limited specifically to examples. Examples are great. They're good things to have. Now, if you really want to pursue that further, I have an 8.5 by 11 sheet that has like 50 things that virtually every conservative church I know does, but there's no specific example of it in the Bible. And then people start backpedaling. No, don't get crazy with examples, okay? Don't abuse them and do stuff they're not supposed to do. Now, I want to hit some examples really quick. So you do your daily Bible reading, and you should, but you shouldn't just go, well, this is a neat story. This is when Adam and Eve, you know, they ate from the tree and they fell, and okay, I read the story. No. What did you learn from the story? Don't just read it to check off, oh, I read my daily Bible reading. That's not studying to show yourself approved. That's checking the boxes. That doesn't count. So you read it, and you see what's there, and we could come up with a bunch of stories, but right now, I'm just going to tell you, don't flirt with sin. God said don't eat it. Don't eat it in the story. Satan comes along, tries to say, you want to go, no, I'm not buying that today. Cain and Abel. So they both bring their offerings to God. God likes one, doesn't like the other. What do we learn? All worship is not equal. I know this isn't a popular thing to say, but all roads do not lead to heaven. Sorry. I don't mean anybody any insult. I don't mean them any harm, but there are a lot of people out there today singing, oh, how I love Jesus, and they ain't on the way. And if you need a book, chapter, and verse for that, which you should require, Matthew 7:21, and he said, and they will say to me in that day, didn't I prophesy in your name, cast out demons your name, do many wonders your name? Verse 23, he says, depart, I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. Just because a group gets together, holds a songbook, reads some passages, doesn't mean they're right with God. And I know that's not a popular thing to say, but all roads don't lead to heaven. And Cain and Abel are an illustration of that. That's not that we wish anybody any harm. This is just, let's get real. If we're going to follow the Bible, this is what the Bible teaches. We can do Nadab and Abihu. Nadab and Abihu, of course, they both came before God, and they offered strange fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. That's right up there at the top. And when they did that, a fire came out from the presence of the Lord and consumed them, and they died before the Lord. Okay, what do you learn from that? Do you learn from that? Oh, I can go worship God any way I want to. I can do anything. Because, you know, God, he's really over there. He's just a begging deity, hoping we'll toss him a bone or a crumb or two. That's not God. He's not a begging deity. If we approach him, we approach him in the right way. You know, in the first Lord's Supper, Mark talked about how he was a kid and he learned to reverence the Lord's Supper. That's how you come before God. Is with reverence and honor. You don't just play your game you want. It doesn't work that way. Nadab and Abihu, awesome example of that. Korah's rebellion. I won't read all of that. That's in Numbers 16:31-35. They got aggravated with Moses, and they thought they ought to be in charge because they didn't like the way Moses was doing it, and they started, you know, getting their rebellion together. And of course, since whoever has the majority's in control, right, must make it okay. No, we found out that just because you have 250 priests offering incense and you got a whole other bunch of folks gathered up with you, that ain't the way God works. When God set a system in order, he set a system in order. And for Korah and his guys, the ground opened up underneath their feet and swallowed them up, and they all died. What you learn there is, we don't mess with God. When he said it, that settled it. Now my job and your job is to get on board with him. Moses' failure. This is at the waters of Meribah. And of course he was supposed to speak to the rock, and he struck the rock, and God said, okay, you can't go to the promised land now. There was some punishment. And the point is, leadership's not an exception to the rules. Now you can get other points out of all of these, but I'm just hitting the highlights. When you're a leader, you're just as much under the rules as everybody else is. That's the way it works. Daddy's not an exception to the rules, even though he's the head of the house. The husband's not an exception, even though he's the head of the wife. You know, just pick any leadership you want. We all give an account to Christ and for the judgment seat of Christ for the deeds done in the body. That's a great example of that. And finally, Uzzah. Uzzah reached out and took hold of the ark because the oxen stumbled, and he was afraid the ark of the covenant was going to fall off of the cart, and so he steadied it. What had God said about touching his ark of the covenant? He said, don't touch it. Don't touch it. What did Uzzah do? Uzzah touched it. What did God do to Uzzah? God killed him. And then the fleshly side goes, well, that's not fair. You were getting ready to fall off the cart. He just saved you. No, God said, don't touch it. And when you think you have an exception to the rule, you be really crazy careful, because just because you think you have an exception doesn't mean God agrees with your exception. We line up with the word. He said, don't touch it. We don't touch it. Kind of a tough one there, isn't it? So we learn to use the light. This is our next to last slide. Your word's a lamp to my feet. There's a light to my path. Now, one of the ways it works to light the way is examples. All of these little stories throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament that illustrate biblical principles that guide us on the straight and narrow. That's the importance of examples. And we could break that out into a 6-week study and really go into it. But that's kind of a nice little synopsis there. There's examples of things done good that are approved. Example of bad things that you don't want to do. Last slide. What are you learning from your Bible examples in your daily reading? What I want you to learn is how to follow closer and closer to Christ. Narrow the gap and get so close to Christ, Satan can't find a place to squeeze in between. If you narrow the gap that much, you're doing excellent. If you haven't got it narrowed that much, like the song says, why do you wait? Get closer. If you haven't put Christ on in baptism yet, we're here to help. While together we stand and sing.